Hi, good evening. I'm Dr. Sridhar. Some of you had requested a lecture on documentation in NICU, both from medical and nursing point of view. So I'll be covering some of the important aspects. It's a very important topic, and obviously, I don't know how much you can see of the portions of the chart that I show you, but I mean, basically it's an understanding of what is needed for it. And you can always look at what you're using in your unit and modify it if needed, or suggest improvements to what I'm presenting here as well. So we learn from each other. The NICU is a intensive and high risk area. Careful documentation is critical to avoid medico-legal issues and complaints. And accurate, timely documentation is crucial. So many times we are busy with the clinical work and documentation takes a back seat. But actually, when you look at the future implications, what we do is equally important to what we document. And there is always a saying that unless you have written it or unless you have entered it in the notes, you didn't do it. So be careful with the documentation. We have different types of documentation. We have the electronic medical records. We have the paper or handheld, hand-filled medical records, and a hybrid model where some parts of the notes are electronic and some are hand-filled. It's very important to have a clear policy in the hospital and in each department as to which format is being followed and be consistent with that to different team members. So we have different forms of documents, the medical or physician notes, which may include the admission notes, the newborn assessment checklist, daily note and progress note, procedure or operative notes, and the discharge summary, transfer note, etc. The nursing notes include the charting of vital signs as well as the different documentation that we need for JCA accreditation or pain scoring. The care bundles necessitate certain documentation as well. So all these are part of the nursing notes. Very important that we are aware of the consent forms that are used in your unit and the similar documentation which are important for medico-legal, like refusal of treatment form, for example. And you may have information leaflets. I will not be discussing that here. So in terms of physician notes, we have the medical notes, and this is a sample which is provided on venturafamilymed.org website. It's similar to what most of us use, and just took it from there for ease. History and physical examination, I mean, obviously you start the initial description with something like newborn baby, boy or girl, born to the mother's age, gravida para, and gestational age in weeks. Then the initial complaints before delivery, presented in labor, I mean, presence or absence of SHRAM. If there was SHRAM, you would write the total time with ruptured membranes. Then the delivery mode, whether the baby was cephalic or breech. This has implications in terms of your planning future ultrasound hip, for example, if it's a breech delivery. And whether it was a cesarean section, whether there were instrumental deliveries, and so on. Delayed cord clamping is part of the NRP guidelines. It's very important we mention whether it was done or not. This is more important in the premature babies, as we have discussed in the different videos on delayed cord clamping. And we mentioned the resuscitation measures and the Apgar score at 1 and 5 minutes. And of course, if the baby needs resuscitation, you would have an extended Apgar score. It's also good practice to have the expanded Apgar score. You may refer my video on that, where we write in clear details of each aspect of the scoring. So it's clear to the people who are observing what has been the actual score. We also cover the maternal details, including the blood group, antibody, whether there is any Coombs positive, indirect Coombs, the hemoglobin of the mother to suggest if there is any anemia in the mother, infection screen including rubella, varicella, VDRL. Urine culture is very important. Sometimes you get ESBL organisms which may cause sepsis in the premature baby, so you may have to broaden your cover in such cases if the baby is symptomatic. Hepatitis B, HIV, and maternal serum alpha fetoprotein, as well as if the triple test was done for trisomy and other tests as relevant. The glucose tolerance test, obviously they would have told you if the mother has gestational diabetes or type 1 diabetes, and you would also need to know about the screening for the glucose tolerance. Group B streptococcal status is routinely done in the Western countries and in UAE and other Middle East parts, but it may not be done routinely in many parts of India. The incidence of GBS in Indian setup is still not clear. The complications of pregnancy should be clearly documented, any pertinent family history and antenatal scan findings. It's very important to be clear about what maternal details. You need to discuss with the obstetric team, and especially if there is a community obstetrician who is delivering in your unit, we should try our best to get the results scanned into the system so we have the results which are important at delivery. Many times we suggest a pediatrician high risk box in the mother's notes, and high alert important results would be entered there, so it's clear to the pediatrician attending the delivery. So when the newborn, once you write the resuscitation and maternal details, you'll be going for the physical exam entry. So birth weight, head circumference and length, which are initially documented, should be entered in the first day's notes. The gestational age should be entered, and if you need to confirm by modified Ballard score, you can enter the score there as well. The vital signs are usually recorded by the nurses, and you can transfer it here. Heart rate, respiratory rate, whether there is any feature of respiratory distress, saturation, temperature and blood pressure. The general assessment of the newborn will include assessment of the skin for rashes or lesions. Sometimes you get cuts from the birth or bruising. You can document that as well. You can also mention the presence of spinal tuft of hair or dimples, which may suggest underlying spina bifida, and also look for early jaundice. You can refer my recent talk on the AAP update on jaundice management. Then you look at the head, ear, eyes, nose and throat. So the red reflex should be examined either at the initial assessment or within the next assessment, so we don't miss it. We should look for it bilaterally. External ears for presence of pits, anterior fontanelle, presence of molding. So molding is more to reassure the family, they'll be worried about the head shape. Cephalomatoma also should be explained clearly to the family. You can refer my videos on these topics as well. So look at the heart palate. You may need to feel it with a gloved finger, or use a tongue depressor to see it clearly with a good light. The ophthalmoscope light is quite useful for this as well. Assess the neck for any concerns. Examination of the cardiovascular system, including the capillary filling time, heart sounds, presence of murmur, presence of pulses, both central and peripheral. And remember that the presence of femoral pulse in the first day doesn't rule out coarctation. Obviously, you need to examine the baby pre-discharge, and the saturation screening is important here as well. In terms of the respiratory system, you evaluate the chest shape, symmetry, air entry, presence of added sounds, any distress features. You can refer my playlist on respiratory distress and additional sounds like stridor. Assessment of the abdomen should mention whether there is soft, full, tense abdomen, whether there is any mass, organomegaly, and bowel sound should be listened to as well. You may have to listen for a little extended period of time to hear the bowel sounds. And abdominal girth, if you're measuring for any reason, you can mention it. In terms of genitourinary, we should assess the genitals in both boys and girls and specify if they are appropriate for the gender and gestation. Some degree of clitoromegaly is normal in growth-restricted female babies. And if there is any ambiguity or anything, you should be mentioning it clearly, and further plan should be according to the examination findings. The hernial orifice assessment is most important in the preterm babies who are approaching discharge. And in the initial stages, it's not common. Of course, you may get hydrocele in many babies, and you should differentiate it from a hernia. Hip assessment, including the Ortolani and Barlow's assessments, and then neurologic assessments, including sensorium, responsiveness, variation in state, tone, both active and passive tone, newborn reflexes, including the Moro, and reflexes, including Gallant, Suck, Root, Gag, as well as a pupillary size and reaction. The head circumference should be documented. I'll be making a video soon on neurologic assessment of the newborn, as requested by some of you. We should next document the assessment and plan. So we have to assess the risk of infection. The early onset sepsis score is used in the developed world. In India, we have to use it according to the setup. If you feel you can reliably use the risk factors from the mother, you can consider using it, but you can have a higher threshold. And we should have a summary of the findings that we mentioned above, and diagnosis should be coded if confirmed. Parent communication should be documented, and always at admission we would be informing the parents, or document that as well. And the orders should be systematically written, including feeding or fluid plan, vital signs monitoring plan, vitamin K, vaccines, newborn screens, antibiotics if needed according to the condition, x-rays, tests as needed. So obviously these are as per the condition of the baby. After the initial admission notes, we have a daily progress notes which has to be written once or twice as per the unit policy. In our unit, in the critical babies, we do it at least twice a day. Of course, there is always an additional progress note when there are changes in the condition, and procedure notes when we do procedures. A parental update note is always added when there is a significant parental update. I would suggest a parental update note at least once in 2-3 days in any NICU baby, so there is clear documentation that they are always updated. So we usually follow the SBAR approach. SBAR is an acronym for Situation, Background, Assessment and Recommendation. It's just a systematic way to go through what needs to be documented, and it can facilitate prompt and appropriate communication without missing out any aspects. So we give a brief overview of the existing problems or problem list, which covers the situation part and the background part. The situation for a progress note, it's already set up. I mean, you know the baby, you're documenting the age, the current weight, and everything will be written. And the background includes a problem list, a short summary of the recent events, especially the previous day, and the review of current results, system-wise summary of the previous day's course. Your examination findings would come here, and all these form part of the assessment. So the plan would be recommendation, and the parental update, as I mentioned, would be documented as well. It's very important to document procedure notes whenever you do a significant procedure like intubation, giving surfactant, insertion of PICC lines, insertion of umbilical lines, lumbar puncture, any other significant test like suprapubic aspiration, for example. So when you do a note, you mention anything technically related to that, for example, the length of the umbilical line inserted, what level you're fixing the endotracheal tube, and what action was taken based on the x-ray review, etc. So this documentation is very important so that the team following you knows clearly that the line has been pulled, for example. The consent process I mentioned earlier, it's very important for medico-legal reasons as well. And most units, in addition to the general admission consent, would have a high-risk consent for the NICU, which is usually taken by the admitting physician. So the physician explains to the parents why the baby is getting admitted, what the likely treatment is, a quick overview of the duration of stay as far as we can predict, and so on. Any procedure not covered by the above high-risk consent or general admission consent would need a separate informed consent, and this you would have a policy in your unit for guiding this, and this can be verbal in case of emergency. This some units take for lumbar puncture, some units don't, but PICC lines, blood transfusions, these usually need consent. And when you're taking the consent for the first blood transfusion, you can always mention that we can proceed with further transfusions just by verbal consent. In case of surgical procedure, retinopathy treatment, etc., it should be the operator who takes the consent, because they are responsible. They have to explain clearly all the complications that's expected from the process, and they should make sure that it is a really informed consent. The discharge summary should be concise and complete. So it shouldn't be too detailed. You don't need irrelevant information. You don't need to put all the results. You don't need to put all the findings. But we need to focus on the condition at discharge, all the problems that have resolved, as well as the important problems that are still unresolved and need monitoring and follow-up, and certain important aspects like the reviews and tests. It's also important to group the appointments for the family's convenience. Most units have pre-designed discharge templates, and it's always good practice to review the discharge summary completeness, take the feedback of the colleagues who are following up the baby in the pediatric clinic, and revise this template from time to time to have more complete utilization.